In the seclusion of central Switzerland, Swiss composer Robert Bachmann finds the peace and quiet he needs to work. This is where his avant-garde compositions take shape and where he prepares himself for his concert appearances as a conductor. His original interpretation of Beethoven's Seventh Symphony at the Budapest Whitsun Festival, for example. Today, Beethoven's reputation is solid and unchallenged. Bachmann's is yet to be established. It often seems that the ears of the world are closed to the music of our own times. Bachmann knows where he's going, and he isn't prepared to make any compromises. An adventurer at heart, he often leaves home to seek inspiration for his work in some of the remotest spots on Earth. This composition is part of my world music cycle, where I take outstanding geographical features as my inspiration. In this case, it's Ayers Rock, or Uluru, in the language of the Australian Aborigines. I chose this monolith because its structure remains the same, although its appearance changes constantly. It's a score for 108 musicians, all of whom play simultaneously. That's the special thing about this composition. So far, we've had no specific problems. In fact, it's been a lot of fun for us all. Henry Wood Hall in London was once a church. Now it's a fully equipped recording studio. It was here that Robert Bachmann recorded his experimental composition, Uluru, with the London Philharmonic. The gigantic score calls for 108 instruments, each playing independently. That's almost the equivalent of four classical symphony orchestras. No fewer than 12 kettledrums and the largest tam-tam in Great Britain were brought in specially for the recording. In a break with convention, the musicians are grouped around the conductor. It takes a lot to surprise experienced professionals like these, but even they were slightly thrown by it all.
Yeah, but it's such a large one, isn't it? Such a large orchestra. I usually know where I'm sitting. I usually sit up there. Everybody's sitting anywhere at the moment.
However, it's not only the musicians who have to find a place in this new order. The work itself has a long way to go before it carves out a niche for itself in the new age of high-tech sound.
This suite is being an experimental piece. But we have 108 players in the orchestra. Each part has an individual part. So although we have 44 strings, we have 44 string parts. And the score is one of the largest scores I've ever worked with. It has 108 staves on a piece of paper. Although the piece is constructed basically from 12 bars, which will be used in various ways, these 12 bars take 108 staves. That is very interesting.
Thank you, more or less.
Thank you.
Hello. After recording each movement, the conductor checks with his producer and sound engineer. Their ears are as sensitive as finely tuned microphones.
Who was that? Hello? Hello? Can we live with this noise at the end?
Yeah. Okay. This time they have to repeat the movement. When you have 108 musicians crowded into a room, the odd unwanted noise is inevitable.
Take itself was good. Please. One, two, three, four. That's fine. Thank you.
Ian Sylvester is a digital multi-track recording specialist. His clients include superstars like Annie Lennox.
More often than not, most of the classical recordings that people do would not be using multi-tracks. They would normally use just a two-track version, or they would have the multi-track just in case something happened to the mix. Now, what Robert Bachman's trying to achieve is have everything that happens in the auditorium that can be recreated in a mix situation, so that instead of having a stereo mix of it, which is, you can't really do that much with a stereo mix, but with multi-tracks, you can recreate the various surround sound as the MD heard it.
Thank you very much.
The recording's over, and it's a big hand from the orchestra for the composer. Bachmann is certain of his audience's approval when the music he conducts is safe, like Beethoven. But his own unconventional work is still in search of a wider audience. And only time will tell if his compositions, penned here in the idyllic setting of the Alpine foothills, will find their place in the annals of musical history.